I would like to introduce our next speaker. It's Professor Morten Madsen, and the title of his presentation is Crystalline Metal Oxide Interfacial Layer for Efficient and Stable Organic Photovoltaics. Floor is yours.
Thank you, Julia. Yeah, so as mentioned, I will talk about some of the work we do on crystalline metal oxide films and how they can be used in OPV application in this case. I would like to mention from the beginning that this is a collaborative work between several groups. So we develop these metal oxide films from reactive sputtering in our lab and make devices from these. But there's also a lot of surface characterization done at different collaborators. So at the NSEM lab, Andreas Schmidt and LBL Berkeley, they do TEM and especially LEAM. Nadine Wikowski at UPMC does XPS and UPS. And Roland Reisel's group at Graz has done the XRD part. And the people in Aarhus has been involved, especially in the titanium oxide part that I would end up with. So we all know the use of metal oxides in PV and in OPV, so I'll not spend so much time introducing it, but at least motivating our angle to the work here. So you can sandwich the metal oxides, of course, as whole transport layers and electron transport layers that we've already shown. The most part of my talk, I will focus on the whole transport layer and the use of molybdenum oxide in these layers. So there's been a lot of work in the past. We have shown some of it we have seen today also, of metal oxides for whole contacts or anode contacts in OPV or together with organic materials. So what kind of energy band alignment you can end up with and how you can induce hole injection or hole extraction from these layers. So in this case here, I will focus on molybdenum oxide in OPV, and that is of course a hole extraction from the donor material to the anode contact. And if one wants to look more into the different oxides you can use and what are the properties of these, I can recommend this paper there from Rainer et al. A couple of years back, some years back now. They investigated a bunch of transition metal oxides and how they make contact to different donor materials in PV-OPV applications. They showed this nice relationship between an offset, energy offset for hole extraction, that you can expect a certain interface between a metal oxide and a donor material in such a system. And they have shown that this depends very much on the difference between the work function of the metal oxide and the ionization energy of the donor material. So if you start out with a low work function of the metal oxide, lower than the ionization energy of the donor material, you have a large offset for carrier extraction, and therefore the barrier at this point is quite large. So this would be the case basically shown for these metal oxides on this end of the spectrum here, where the work function is lower than the ionization energy of the organic material. But of course, as you move on here to different metal oxides, you increase the work function, so you're lowering the difference. At some point, they become equal to each other and you have a minimum offset, and if you even increase the work function further, you are left with this minimum offset further on. So basically showing that, of course, you need a high work function metal oxide that surpasses the Homo level of the donor material in order to really make efficient contact and carry extraction, hole extraction in these devices. It's also been shown that molybdenum oxide can replace P-dot. This is work from Heger's group some years back, replacing P-dot. It's basically generating OPV devices with relatively similar efficiencies, but the really nice results came out on the stability in these devices that they generate more stable contacts. Now, our angle to this here, in recent years, we have done some work on reactive sputtering of molybdenum oxide, or metal oxides in general. And the nice thing with reactive sputtering is that you can tune the composition. So what is many times done is that you evaporate the metal oxide, simply taking, for example, MO3 powder and you evaporate it on your active layer or on your electrode, and you're left with the stoichiometry you have from the initial powder. From reactive sputtering, what you can do is you can put in a molybdenum target and you can spot off molybdenum. Now, if you then introduce oxygen into the chamber while you do that, what you can end up with is you can tune the composition of your metal oxides. And that's a nice method to tune the properties, a lot of these metal oxides. So of course you would have to have a careful relationship between the spotter power you use to spot off your metal and the amount of oxygen you put into your chamber. So you can easily end up with having, say, sputtering off metal at too low rates and not having in enough or having too much oxygen in there, so you basically make a superoxided films because reactions take place at the target rather than during the deposition or at the surface where you're forming your oxide. But if you find the right ratio, you can tune between something that is substoichiometric or called superoxided films. And this is shown here from RPS data that you can go from something MO2.6 up to MO3.2, which leads to quite modified optoelectronic properties, both in terms of conductivity, in terms of transmission, and so on. We have shown some of this work in this paper here some years back. Now, what we wanted to do, of course, is to introduce these layers into devices and make them use as Hall contacts. And what we see for all these films deposited at room temperatures is that they are amorphous, and they possess also, therefore, quite low work function. So we have investigated from TEM, we see basically no crystalline features appearing. And when we look at the work functions probe from UPS, we see that we have, at these room temperature samples, we have quite low work functions. So I should mention, these are samples that are made in our lab or grown in our lab, and then they are shipped to France where the UPS is done. So of course they have seen air, and that may also influence what you measure on. So part of this work function increase that happens here when you heat up the sample is also basically that you clean the sample in situ while you're probing your work function. But definitely what we see is we see a large peak happening when you heat up further your samples after deposition that comes from a structural reorganization or crystallization of the metal oxide. So at this point, even around here, before 200 degrees, we have no more carbon contamination on the surface, but we still see a big increase in work function. So you can increase the work function from annealing these, and of course this is something that should have good application properties for devices. When we look at TEM on these here, they look quite different as I said before. So here now we clearly see that we have these really highly crystalline films. Actually, in some of the images, they form basically all over the TEM stampedium, so quite large domains of this alpha phase orthorhombic molybdenum oxide. But this is not the case all over. At the very top surface, we see an interface or a boundary to something that is, well, not with the same crystallinity or amorphous to some extent. So in order to probe what is really happening on the surface, for these films, we did these LEEM investigations, or this was done at LBL Berkeley. With LEEM, you can send in low-energy electrons on your surface with a high lateral resolution, and if you scan the energy of the electrons that you probe with above and below the work function, basically what you get out is a work function map with this high lateral resolution of the LEEM technique. So this is an interesting technique for this kind of complex oxides, because we see that we have these structural formations that we also see from the AFM when you heat them up. So we go from something that is very smooth surfaces to getting these nano aggregates on the surface when we crystallize them. And these nano aggregates, they come out in the LEEM picture. So there you see that you have areas with really high work function, and you have areas where you have a bit reduced work functions. And these reduced work function areas, they resemble these nano aggregates that we see from AFM. We also see from XPS, I did not show that here, but we see from XPS also that we have this reduced composition when we heat it up to very high temperatures. So we do crystallize the surface, we form this complex oxide. This complex oxide has a high work function, and the picture looks something like this here. We go from amorphous, we form this very crystalline surface, and the bulk, this is the background image of the LEEM. It has work functions close to these 6.9 that you see for in situ prepared molybdenum oxide. But then we have these features on top, these nanoaggregates that are slightly reduced in composition, and they show a little bit lower work function. In either case, it's still a high work function metal oxide that should be useful for Hall contacts. Of course, in this case here, as you can see also here, this is done on silicon, all these studies that we showed in these two papers last year. But for devices, of course, we would have to embed them directly on ITO surfaces. So our next work was to make devices from these, and we formed this kind of device stack here. So we have ITO as the transparent conductive electrode. We formed the molybdenum oxide on top from the reactive sputtering or from thermal deposition to compare as a reference device. And then on top, we evaporate a small molecule, a DPP C70 as the active layer mixture, and then BCP silver as the top contact. Now, for devices, we see that those sputtered films that are formed at room temperature, that basically the devices are not working. We saw before that we had this quite low work function for these amorphous molybdenum oxide layer, which could explain the really poor Hall contacts. So they should not also work. When we heat them up to higher temperatures, as you say, on ITO, we see the crystallization to happen at lower temperatures that we see on silicon. So we don't need to heat them up to that high after all, even though it is still pretty high at 350. But at this point, we see that the device performance really increase, and actually they compare roughly, I would say, to those made from thermally evaporated molybdenum oxide formed at room temperature. If we investigate in more detail what is happening, then why do we see this this increase on ITO and what is happening with the thermal oxide for these? And we can look at the evolution of the PCE when we heat up the surface here, and for the spot-out molybdenum oxide, we start out with this very low power conversion efficiency for these low work function metal oxides, and then at higher temperatures, we start to get device performance that are well resembling these of the room temperature deposited molybdenum oxide. If we look at XRD to investigate these on ITO surfaces now, not on silicon, we also see that this correlates quite nicely with the device performances. So at room temperature, even up to 200 degrees, we see for the spotted oxide no peaks in our XRD spectrum. But when we go to 350, we start to see these clear crystalline features. So these crystalline features, of course, come from the molybdenum oxide now being crystallized. That should form this high work function metal oxides, which makes it a good whole extraction layer, and that should lead to this high device performances. We did also do the LEAM studies in case of the metal oxides on ITO, and roughly they resemble those on silicon. Here again, formed at a little bit lower temperatures. We see a bit complex oxide with these nano aggregates, but basically in all cases we are above 6 eV, which is a high work function, definitely above the homo energy of DVP, so that should make it a good contact for hole extraction in such a device. Which explains that we need to go up to these temperatures to form it. Now, one interesting thing we see is that for the spot-out molybdenum oxide and the thermal molybdenum oxide, we see quite differences, quite different behavior when we heat them up. Here I show the XPS data for these two films, and what we see for the spot-out is that we can heat them up quite a lot without changing the composition. When we go to very high temperatures, we see a slight reduction in the oxide, but it's not a lot. So these here seems to, but they form these crystalline layers, and they are quite resilient towards this heat treatment annealing. Opposite is the case for the thermal deposit of molybdenum oxide. When we heat this up, we see that we already at low temperature starts to reduce the metal oxide. So basically, this is done by vacuum annealing. We put in vacuum and heat it up. So what happens is we lose oxygen when we heat it up, but we lose significantly more oxygen in the thermally deposited molybdenum oxide than we do for the spot-out oxide. So that can also, if we go back here, explain the drop in performance that we see here for the thermal deposited when we heat that up. So we are losing oxygen. That means that the oxide becomes less transparent, first of all. But also, when you have a reduced oxide, you are starting to lower the work function of that oxide. So at some point, you lower the work function below the homo level of the contact layer, and that should give you a drop in device performances. So we think that this this picture here of the resilience towards heat treatment explained this trend in device performance. What was interesting for us was to do the stability analysis also with these devices. And we did stability analysis for 240 hours for these cells, so basically tracking under light soaking. And what we see is that the spot-out molybdenum oxide, it forms devices based on the spot-out oxide are definitely more stable than the one formed from the thermally deposited metal oxide. There's two points I want to comment on here. I mean, one thing is this question will probably pop up, why we see this drop here at the very beginning. And there was some answers used yesterday, quite a lot, which was basically, I don't know. And I will repeat that answer here because we don't know at the moment. But it's something that we have checked, of course, that we see that repeatedly. We see that repeatedly for the spotted oxide, yes. We also compared it up against literature. There are some investigations done for stability of molybdenum oxide-based OPV, where they also see this drop in VOC, based mainly in VOC, that leads to this kind of change in the beginning. So we try to understand this at the moment, but we don't have a clear answer. But still, what we repeatedly see when we compare multiple devices is that we always see the spotted oxides perform more stable devices. And our suggestion is that it is the resilience of these oxides towards heat treatment, probably also to UV treatment, because you see that many of the oxides, they tend to lose oxygen also during UV treatment. And we at the moment try to investigate the stability of the pure oxides to see the difference between the spot-out and the thermal but I think definitely for stability purposes, this could be interesting. The last couple of minutes I have, I will spend on mentioning that we also do work on the electron transport layer. So instead of molten oxide going to a low band gap, low work function metal oxide, we have done work on titanium oxide recently. Interestingly, titanium oxide typically show that you have this light soaking effect in the very beginning of the curve because you form traps in the oxide and that leads to this S-shaped curve. So you need to illuminate it for some time to lose that S-shaped curve. Our recent results for this, when we do this sputtering process on the titanium oxide, is also you can form titanium oxide films that gives S-shaped free curves for OPV devices that we develop. So we expect them to be kind of defect-free films. Again, we are treating them with heat, and we also probe with XRD the crystallinity, and we see for room temperature, basically, we do not see any crystalline peaks arising from the oxide, but they start up around 100, 150 for titanium oxide, and this is also where we start to see the improving in device performance again. So at room temperature, amorphous films, basically devices not working, going to 100 degrees, we start to see devices working, but we have a little bit of S-shape. Going to 150, where we have this crystalline peak more clear, devices are working well, no S-shape to begin with. So we, of course, would like to look into stability of these titanium oxide-based cells also, but this is also somehow ongoing work. The very last slide is more a motivation slide for future work, or should I say. Sometimes presenting this, people will say, yeah, but you use high temperatures, and this is sputtering, and is that good at all for OPV? We develop roll-to-roll process modules in our lab now, and part of what we do is also we do roll-to-roll vacuum deposition. We have a roll-to-roll sputter line, so we do this reactive sputtering also on rolls, and we have started the work on the titanium oxide and would, of course, like to extend that to some of the other oxides. I agree, for molybdenum oxide, you would need to lower the temperature more, but there's things you can play with sputtering processes that can induce crystallization at lower temperatures. You can play with sputter power pressure and so on instead of the temperature alone. So this is something we are looking into at the moment. So at the end, I would like to thank also people from my group. In the work of the metal oxides that we do here, it's especially actually Andre, who is not no longer in my group. He got a postdoc at LBL Berkeley, but he's collaborating on that work there, doing the LEAM things. Merat is doing a lot on the devices here, integrating the metal oxides into OPV devices, in case of, especially for the molybdenum oxide. Mina did work with the Aarhus people on the titanium oxide, so yeah. I want to also, of course, thank Stabelnext Oil for giving me the chance to talk here today, and also for the contribution along the way for this work here. And in general, thanks for funding. I should highlight our ITN project that ThinFace that funded part of this work also. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. Now we have time for a couple of questions.
Very nice talk. I'm sorry I didn't see it at the beginning, but very nice work. For me, my experience with semiconductor oxides and organic, also not perovskite, but on organic solar cells, you can use whatever you want as oxide. You can synthesize at low temperature, high temperature, you can heat it. You will have differences in efficiency, but you can get very good efficiency. It doesn't matter what you use in general, okay? The problem is stability. Okay, always the problem is stability. Yes, I agree that the efficiency can be improved by ozone treatment, but these binary oxides are very active in UV light. Can you comment on that? Do you know any test about it?
No, I mean, I can comment that I agree on that. Basically, also what I show is for our crystalline sputtered films, we see device performances and efficiencies that are comparable to those you see from thermally deposited. So if you look purely on an efficiency point of view, maybe it's not so interesting, but stability-wise, there's differences. And I think what we see is that these oxide tends to change composition a long time with heat treatment, with light exposure. This is something you have normally for OPV cells, for any cell you put up there, it'll also be for perovskites. So I think work that addresses more how the metal oxides change during these exposures. The metal oxides alone, without the active layers and the other components, of course, the degradation from these, is the way to look into. And we try to do this here, and we definitely see differences between, for example, these sputtered and the thermal deposited ones. So yeah, I agree that there are differences, and these should be looked at.
Thank you. Other questions? Monica again?
You show a slide of the molybdenum oxide. Can you show it? Remember, do you have a molybdenum oxide? I think it was two different sizes.
Oh, it's for the stability or?
That one. In the red curve, the next one. So the red curve is 30 nanometers molybdenum oxide at 350. Why you have this increase in efficiency at the beginning?
This one starts up, it's normalized. It's just at the time scale that you don't see the drop. So as I mentioned, there's a drop and a recovery process, and we see that consistently for the sputtered oxide. There's some kind of photo-induced transformation happening at the very early time scales. So there's a drop in efficiency that comes from VOC FF chains, and that recovers back. And we are not quite sure why. So this is what I mentioned. I'm
not worried about the drop, the black one. I'm worried about the red one.
Oh, I'm talking about the red one also.
Okay.
What you mean is this increase or?
It's weird that increase, right? The efficiency with time.
Yeah. I mean, there's a very fast drop here, at very short time scales.
Okay.
You cannot see it here because you would have to zoom in on that. But at very short time scales, it drops and then it recovers. Oh, it stops. They're normalized. They start up here, right? And then I cannot tell you the exact time scale, but it happens within the first hour. You see a big change, and then it recovers from this change. And I'm honestly not sure why. We have compared up against literature and seen that this has been seen before for molybdenum oxides. You have this VOC drop and recovery, but we would have to look more into it in order to understand it and explain it. No, it doesn't happen again. And the reason why we use different thicknesses here is we actually did the 30 nanometer also for the thermal. They tend to be lower here, so this is kind of the best performing composition for each. But still, we see for the sputter, they're still better in all cases.
Thank you. Let's thank speaker again.